your truck buddies were running with me, like, you know, you just intentionally ring them off the crossfire, send them up into the
stands. What a dick.
Yeah, like, guys used to do that. There's no netting back there, and the students actually, like, the kids up there, they're nuts, they take the pucks and put them back down.
Pucks in Deep, episode number 71 here. I'm your co-host, Connor Thelman.
And I'm your co-host, James Murray. Connor, what do we got today?
Boy, I'm glad you asked, James. Do we have a 14-year NHL starting tendy?
Just a vet, perhaps? A guy that, absolute legend here.
I mean, did he play for the University of Maine and just put it on top of his large, large shoulders?
He did.
I think so.
And Puka necklace, yeah.
And that Puka necklace. Yeah. A couple of them he had to go through, apparently. Yeah. But yeah, we got Jimmy Howard on the pod today. So yeah, we know people are tuning in. This is a biggie, and couldn't have been a cooler guy.
I mean, if you're a kid starting between the pipes right now, you better be listening to this, because this guy's got some good advice and an experience that you're going to want to hear about, and might, get you to stop some more pucks, you know?
Yeah, and a guy who just lives and breathes hockey. I mean, he's out of the game now. Said he, like, he doesn't miss playing tendy too much, but it sounds like he's watching, you know, everything going on. Like, he knew...
He's aware.
The new college hockey programs going around, he's talking about Penn State, Arizona State. He's talking about... You know, possibly Syracuse, which we might have brought up, but I mean, also he's talking with Swayman, you know, current, you know, Maine alums there. Like, he's around the game of hockey, and he's coaching his sons now too. So just a rink rat,
But
love to see it.
Oh, man, just congratulations to Jimmy here, and on a 14-year career, hell of a career, and you know, he shut down our Wild plenty of times, but also just a brick wall at Maine. So yeah. I mean, this guy's, you know, like we talk about later in the pod, he had so many people to look up to. Well, now he's one of those mentors for the younger goalies of, you know, this generation. So,
right.
Exciting interview with Jimmy here, and it's probably one of our best episodes. You guys are going to like it. So,
yeah. So make sure you're tuning in for that one. Otherwise, let's, they're not too much to break down since our last pod in college hockey news here.
A little bit of news.
Let's start with the big one. Carves signing with UMass
just
through 2026. What was it? The UMass Reindeers, like, so that's seven more chips just like booked. I mean, You had to re-sign him, obviously, or extend him. Yeah. Not like he was, you know, the contract was ever going to be up there. But it's basically like he's there as long as he wants to be.
Seven more years of reindeer in the stands, it sounds like.
Yeah, and but never lose that spin reindeer. Zone, where does D. Mike go when his contract? Or is he just going to be the associate wagon?
I don't know. Maybe he's a new head coach of Syracuse one day. We don't. Ooh. Yeah, who knows? But
kind of like that.
I think they need D. Mike in the locker room there right now. And that's
definitely
a huge piece.
Do.
Carves Arsenal. So, good things for UMass.
I'd say they're a package deal.
You know what we did not ask Jimmy on the pod?
What?
And I'm mad about the new head coach, Mr. Barr.
Well, yeah. Well, I mean, we kind of asked about like the new facilities. And
yeah,
the new,
that's part of what
we should have asked about Ben Barr. I'm sure he would have had a take. You know, Jimmy, that's our bad. That's on us.
That's on us. And sorry, Barr. We still want to come up to Maine if you let us. And we'll do some good work.
Benny, I think we didn't have to ask because it goes without saying.
We're getting big skated.
You're going to turn that place around. And we fucked that one up.
We did fuck that one up.
That's on us. Hey, still big Maine guys.
We're big Maine guys. You know, a little problem with the audio today, but all around, it was just a gritty pod. And
We're not used to being up and working on the pod, at least this early in the morning. But usually I'm unloading a freight truck right now. I'm not actually talking. You know, like if someone's talking to me with this much energy in the morning, I'm like, get the hell out of my face.
I'm fitting kids for skates right now. But you know, today it was podcast.
It was Jimmy Day.
Jimmy Howard. And now I gotta drive to Kansas to go watch a Coast playoff game. It's just gonna be gritty.
Dude, that's pucks deep.
That is pucks deep. But
we live for East Coast Ploffs. That's what it's all about.
Oh man, but meeting our last podcast guest, Cappy tonight. Too. It's gonna be a great
night. Right. Yeah. Seeing Cappy in that, I mean, that in person, that's gonna be electric.
Yeah, well,
especially going up against our boy.
Who knows what's gonna happen after the game too. So
yeah, that's excited for that. What else in college hockey news? The signing. So St. Thomas, obviously, they announced Rico Blasi, you know, a month ago or two for the men's program. Just I think it was yesterday or 2 days ago.
2 days ago, I think.
St. Thomas women's coach just got signed. The former associate head coach Joel Johnson, who was with the Gophers for I think like 16 seasons, something like that.
Yeah.
Underneath Brad Frost. So that's actually a pretty big signing for the Tommies there. And
they're
gonna be
good.
Mr.
Johnson, man. It's a big job to take on, new program, and I'm excited. And that's gonna help, you know, grow the women's game. So
exactly.
Right guy for the job with a winning history. So I think, the Tommies are in good hands there. But Yeah, I mean, that's...
I'm surprised Brad Frost let him go so close to home. That's got to be...
really across the street.
Like,
what's
you
up,
son
man?
Of a... All right. Uh-huh, it's going to be a good time.
Yeah, no. No, other news in college hockey, is there any other big news that we got? I mean,
We have... So NHL playoffs are going. There's still only like a couple of guys.
Caulfield's going to the conference finals.
Just
man.
Feeding backdoor tappies for the game winners. So see you, Winnipeg. Didn't really show up at all for that series.
Yeah.
Otherwise, I mean, we still got, you know, Avalanche Vegas is turning into a good series. So yeah, there's a lot of guys, you know, playing from this past year in college hockey in the current NHL playoffs.
Yeah, I mean.
Well, yeah, past 2 years. But I mean, just like Caulfield, Sway Show.
Mm-hmm.
What else we got? New Hook, Sampo.
Yeah, I mean, there's a bunch of guys.
Names are endless out here.
Yeah, and it's good. I think when we were talking to Dan the other day, it's like this is tied for the second most all time for players to make their debut and play in the playoffs, same years they played in the NCAA tournament. So
yeah.
So, tied in like 1986 record. So it's good for
ECH
college hockey.
Has something to do with that?
I would say so. I think everyone deserves the ECH bump.
Mm-hmm.
Just thought about this. Like, we can't really give Jimmy an ECH bump. And not that he ever would need one.
I don't think he needs the bump. Maybe for his son's playing.
Maybe just like best of luck. You know, best of luck coaching four kids.
Yeah. And don't get kicked out of the rink when your son's getting in a fight and you're just
Jimmy
yelling
just
at the refs.
Jimmy just gets tossed in the first. Yeah. I remember, God, I mentioned this pod a lot. But of course, he's just on Chicklets last month. But
was it talking about when he was firing shots at
his kids? No. That's
that was like
stuff.
My favorite. I wanted to bring that up.
No, but he talks like, about he's playing in the A and he's in, I think it was, he said Rochester, and you know, 4 minutes into the game and his parents are there and his goalie coach is there and he's got to drop the mitts. And God,
we should have talked about
that got me fired up. Like, this guy's perfect for pucks and deep. He fits the image. You know, this guy dropped the mitts in pro hockey as a goalie.
Didn't want to. Had the whole family there. It doesn't even get to play more than like 4 minutes. Yeah, he was ready for it.
I mean,
also, can we talk about how scared I was at the beginning of that pod? I was just like, yeah, thanks for having me on. James, you want to go? Right away, I was like, holy shit, it's Jimmy Howard.
It's Jimmy Howard.
So I was a little starstruck in the first couple minutes, but then we get into it.
Cool dude, and obviously, yeah, just another stud out of Maine, and they keep coming, so.
Yeah, I mean, Maine's going to be back. Ben Barr is going to build that place back up. Their goalie right now, I can't think of his name.
They had one rough year. It's not like they've been struggling. I mean, that atmosphere is always the same. They're always competitive, and...
They would have qualified for the tournament the year Sway was there.
They got the new locker room, like you said, you know, the whole
the Naked Five's gonna be back.
The
in
Naked
building
Five's
this year.
Back. All the sports are getting improvements in their weight rooms and all that stuff. So
one thing you'll hear in this episode is that Wit Dog used to love firing shots off the crossbar into the student section of Maine there. So let's just say that happens to you. You get hit by a puck and you need some money to cover that. We can help you out potentially, James. You know, how can we help the people pay for their medical bills?
Yeah, man, if you're losing some jibs due to Wit there, you're going to want to download the top-rated DraftKings app now and use promo code THPN when you sign up and get your free shot at $10,000 in total prizes. Mm-hmm. Again, that's code THPN. Head to DraftKings pool page to get your shot at huge cash prizes. That's promo code THPN. Eligibility restrictions apply. See DraftKings.com for full details.
One take.
That's how we do it. Jimmy fucking
here.
Howard, baby.
It's,
let's get this shit
it's
going.
Jimmy time.
Jimmy!
Yeah. All right, welcome back to Pucks in Deep. This is episode number 71 here. And joining us this week, we have a very special guest. That's right, we got former University of Maine goaltender, setting damn near every record while he was there, and then a 14-year legend for the Detroit Redwings organization, Jimmy Howard. Jimmy, thanks for joining the show.
Hey guys, thanks for having me.
Hey, pumped to have you on here. I mean, James, do you want to kick it off with the first question? I got goosebumps right now.
I'm just pumped to have Maine Black Bear on the pod. We had Swayman on last summer, I believe.
Yeah, yeah, third
round,
because we had Pat Shea.
Well, oh yeah, yeah.
The first one.
Yeah, that's right. That's true.
Legend,
we had Patty.
So.
Sorry, Pat.
Yeah.
But yeah, no, man, pumped to have you on. How's retirement been treating you?
Retirement's been treating me well. It's busy. Didn't realize how busy it was around here for my wife until, you know, it's been the fold. But I'm coaching both my boys in hockey, and so they have me at the rink, you know, 6 out of 7 days. And thank goodness it's finally over. I can put the coaching bag down for, you know, a couple of months.
There you go, and relax.
But, it's been fun. It's been, you know, a change. Obviously, you know, miss being around the guys, everything like that, down in the dressing room. But
yeah.
To say that I actually miss it, it's probably a stretch. Probably, you know, put my body through hell every single day. Don't miss that. Love waking up stress-free. So it's been a good transition so far.
Well, I do want to say congratulations on a hell of a career, and you know, both your time at Maine and with the Red Wings there. You're fun to watch, that was for sure. And yeah, no, good for you to be retired and happy now with the family, whole ass family going on. So
yeah. Even as a Wild fan, fun to watch.
Even as a Wild, yeah. Yeah, we're based in Minnesota. Where are you at now?
I'm still in Michigan.
Michigan?
Okay. We're Michiganders now. We live in
a
suburb just outside of Detroit.
Okay.
And this is, you know, all four kids were born here in town, and this is going to be home, you know, for the foreseeable future. So,
hey.
So we're, you know, excited. We love the area, and love how welcoming everyone is. So, you know, it's just that this is home.
Nice. Well, there's plenty of Michigan college hockey teams to choose from once the young ones grow up. So, have your pick there.
Oh, yeah?
I don't know why, but they love Michigan State.
Wow, Sparties. They're listening to this one. They're not listening to that. That's big.
Let's just go to Maine quick, though. I want you just to get right into it. First of all, how was the campus at Maine? What was it like, you know, back when you played?
Well, I fell in love with it. The Alphon Arena obviously just sold itself. But I fell in love with the campus. You know, it was relatively, you know, big but small at the same time. Mm-hmm. And when I was on campus there for my official visit, it just felt like home. It was a good fit for me. Dean from upstate New York, 45 minutes south of Ottawa.
Mm.
It just had, you know, the same type of feel. So when I got dropped off at the airport by Grant Stanbrick, and I was like, yeah, this is a spot for me. So I committed right there at the Bangor International Airport. So the campus itself, I mean, it all revolves around hockey up there.
Yeah, that's got to be a good feeling.
When I was at school.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
I don't think it's changed.
It probably hasn't changed. No. Yeah.
I don't know. I only see it there in the summer months. We got a lake house back there on one of the lakes.
Oh, nice. We've
been there for about 6 weeks. So I only see the campus during the summertime. Usually not much going on up there.
Well, how about the Alphon? I'm sure you've heard them. Maybe you contributed. I don't know. But they're them getting some renovations now. How excited are you for that? And what are your thoughts on that? Their new locker room looks, it's going to look amazing and everything.
Yeah, it looks sweet.
I mean, it's great. I think it's awesome that they're keeping the Alphon.
Yeah.
There was talks of, you know, ripping it down and just starting fresh.
Yeah,
that
would be tragic.
They're just going to, you know, after seeing the renderings and everything like that, the fact that they're keeping the building, they're just, you know, they're going to spruce it up, which we all know it needs.
yeah, right.
You know, but just to be able to compete, like, that's a huge tool
mm-hmm.
for schools. You know, you see these big time programs and what they can provide for their student athletes. You know, it's a big leg up on the competition when you can show, you know, a 16, 17 year old, like, hey, look at our facilities. And then they go somewhere out east to a, you know, a school that's, you know, more traditional, probably doesn't, you know, a state school probably doesn't have as much money as some of these top programs that, you know, it's kind of an unfair, you know, competition field when it comes to that. So the fact that they're willing to, you know, dump, you know, money into the Alphon, but also, you know, all the sports across the board there are getting upgrades. And that's, you know, it's going to be huge for their sports programs moving forward.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think they did the right thing, that's for sure. Keeping, you know, you still got the character of the Elf, and then now you're just adding, you know, this nice locker room like North Dakota has or any other school, the Big Ten schools. So
UMass getting one too, like the Hockey East, everybody's kind of upgrading, it seems so. You got to follow suit there.
Yeah, you have to. It's
otherwise you can't.
That, right? Especially in this, you know, today's day and world where all these schools, you know, have, you know, the nice facilities. You got to be able to have that facility to be able to compete. I mean, let's be honest, I think a lot of these college facilities might be better than the pros.
Yeah, I know we had
dump money into their program.
That's true.
Bernard Docker on last 2 weeks ago, and he's talking about, you know, he played at North Dakota. He's like, man, that's better. I mean, the Sens have it nice, but he liked it better North Dakota than Ottawa, so.
Yeah, the Ralph is
just. I mean, that's just like, it's crazy to think about, but it's competitive, man. You have to be able to recruit, and that's something that the kids want or need.
Yeah, it's legit. I was wondering, you know, I listened to your interview on Spit and Chicklets, and you talked about going on a visit with BU. Was there any other schools that you were considering going for college there, or was it always, was it between those two, Maine and Boston University?
No, it wasn't just the, there was Colorado College was in the mix, Michigan okay. State, BU, BC, Ohio State University.
Yeah, that's a lot.
and Miami of Ohio. But I didn't even take my visit to Ohio State or Miami of Ohio just because when I was at Maine, I fell in love with it there, like I said. But you know, the one school that I wanted to go to that I didn't even get an official visit to go on was St. Lawrence University.
Really?
Oh. Because that, I mean, I grew up 20 minutes from there.
Oh, okay. So, yeah.
So, like, I was always over at the Saints games. My dad would take me over to watch the practice because he knew the coaches. And I always wanted to be a Saint. I didn't even get a phone call. Well, I did get a phone call. It was, you know, Jimmy, we've got our two goalies. We're not going to recruit you this year.
it's even worse.
Don't even call.
I promise you, wherever you go to school, we'll have you in for a, you know, home and home. So it was, you know, at the time, it was Marshall was the coach there, and he kept his word. You know, invited Maine in for, you know, homestand beginning of my sophomore year. And, you know, I kept my word to my dad. So
that's pretty cool, though.
Yeah. Did you beat them, hopefully, I'm guessing, in that home and home series?
I think, yeah, we swept them at St. Lawrence, and then we, I think we split or went 1-1-1 back in Maine.
Okay. It's got to feel good, though.
Yeah.
Totally.
It was a long time
ago. Yeah. Fair enough, but. All in all, it sounds like a W, so that's good. And things worked out well at Maine, you know.
I'd say so.
Yeah, we should just jump into that. I mean, your first two seasons, I didn't even know. You were splitting time a little bit with Frank Doyle. You know, what was that like? Was that difficult? Because, like, I mean, your numbers were still solid then, obviously, and you got the run for, you know, the title run in 2003, 2004. But what was it like, you know, kind of splitting time there?
It wasn't difficult at all. I mean, it felt like... Okay. No matter who we had in that, you know, gave us a solid chance to win every single night. And, you know, we had, you know, such solid teams in front of us.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we played, you know, we played to our system and to our strengths really well. And that was, you know, we grinded on teams who were really solid on the PK. We chipped in on the power play. So it was, you know, it was always a team effort up there. But the splitting time, it was all that I ever knew.
Yeah.
You know, being at the U.S. program, you know, playing juniors before that, it was always just, you know, split, rotate games, you know, back and forth. So it was all I ever knew until, you know, my junior year when I played, you know, the bulk of the game. So I didn't know any different. I just, you know, when my number was called on the weekend, I just went out there and played, you know, gave it my all. But just, it was just that sophomore year was just a fun year, even though I missed, you know, 5 weeks with a knee injury. You know, I came back and everything just picked up right where it left off.
Yeah. I mean, you talked about splitting time there. Was it ever a scare? Like when you're, you know, a freshman at Maine, like, oh, am I going to get enough playing time? Did I make the right decision? Was that ever a thought in your head at all or no?
No, it was never a thought in my head at all because I wanted to go somewhere where I'd have to, you know, chance to start right away.
Yeah, yeah.
And out of all the schools, that, you know, just seemed like a logical, you know, choice because Matt Yates and Mike Morrison were both graduating.
Yeah.
So it was just Frank and I. So we, Frank sat out the year before because he went to an OHL camp and stayed for, you know, that longer than 48 hours or whatever it is that you're allowed.
That's true.
That jumped from school back in the day. So, it was just him and I. So it was, you know, we were great friends. You know, we used to be, you know, partners in golf matches together. So, you know, I haven't seen or spoken to him in a while, but, we pushed each other to do the best that we could.
What was it like playing in Maine, just the alpha on there, like having that basically seventh man on the ice for you guys? Like that student section's insane. Like,
especially in the heyday.
Oh God.
The alpha on here's in the tournament every single year. You know, like, was it just especially crazy then compared to, I mean, they still get really good crowds now, but like their teams aren't nearly as dominant as they were.
I mean, obviously it was a different atmosphere. When we were playing like BU, UNH, BC, compared to the rest of the Hockey East. I don't know how it is. Now I haven't been able to go back for you know, a game in a while, but when I just remember there being such a buzz that week, you know, leading up to one of those three teams coming to campus.
Oh yeah.
It didn't, it wasn't just Friday, you know, Friday morning. Like there was a lead up from, you know, Monday to, you know, Friday, you know, kids getting excited that, you know, as we're preparing for the week and then, you know, being warm, you know, warming up, you know, up on the concourse, you know, before the games and seeing how far the student section, you know, would be up wrapped around the football field. It was like, okay, like here we go. Like, this is a different animal of the game. I, like, I remember my first one against UNH in early November and Mari Creator won it in that overtime 2-1 and the place just erupted.
Yeah.
And it's the loudest, you know, I've ever heard of building, you know, in my lifetime. So it was fun to be a part of that, to, you know, hear kids, you know, throwing snowballs at BU, you know, when they were pulling in on the campus. So it was always a, you know, intense rivalry with those three teams.
That's great for college hockey. We need more of that and get back to those old days. But
yeah.
I mean,
yeah, your rivalries.
You're lucky you got to play in the Alphon, in the Joe. Like, you got to play in some historic buildings. What was your favorite barn to play at, though, in college hockey, other than the Alpha, obviously? What was your favorite place to travel to?
I loved playing at UNH.
Yeah. I mean, a big rival, yeah. So yeah.
Just because, you know, that state rival between both schools, but you know, and at the pro level, I always loved playing in Chicago.
Can you go wrong with that?
Square Garden, like Madison Square Garden, was right up there at the top as well. But yeah, I mean, being able to play at the Joe and the Alphon too, you know, historic buildings in their own rights was you know, very special.
Yeah, it's pretty cool, man. Be between the pipes for both those arenas. I mean,
yeah.
What was your, I mean, while we're on the topic, what was your time like? Do you like the XL Energy Center here in St. Paul?
Pardon?
Do you like the XL Energy Center in St. Paul when you came to play the Wild?
Yeah.
Just gotta know.
So I gotta know. Cool. Yeah.
Like, it's such a unique concept for a building. You know, you can walk into, you know, a lot of these buildings and they sort of just sort of mimic each other. And,
yeah.
You know,
it's
like
unique.
A cabin feeling.
Yeah,
right?
It is. It is.
It's so cool. It's like you're having a lake life and then, you know, hockey breaks out. People that I just love, like, all the wood and, you know, the slate everywhere. And,
yeah, no, they did a good job. Yeah,
it just makes you feel like you're going to your lake house.
All the jerseys wrapped around, too.
You've got all the high school jerseys wrapped around the outside.
Yeah, that's my favorite part.
It's super cool, too. Like, guys are walking, you know, the first time there and they're like, what's all these jerseys? I was like, those are high school jerseys. That's how big, you know, high school hockey is out here.
Yeah.
Like, they don't play juniors, everyone plays for the hometown in their high school. It's pretty neat.
Yeah, that's what it's all about.
You guys do it the right way.
Yeah, no, I think Michigan's on board. You know, they're getting up there. What are you guys don't, it's still not high school hockey in Michigan, is it right now? It's, what is it?
It is.
Tier one and tier two.
Diehard over AAA hockey.
Yeah, it's, I don't, I mean.
It's ridiculous. It's sickening the way people, you know, just jump teams, whatever it takes. And I feel like we have too many AAA programs. I mean, we have six here.
Jeez. I don't know. Six.
I feel like six is too many.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's quite a bit. I kind of want to touch on, you know, the Frozen Four run in that season. I mean, I was looking up, you guys had 10 wins in a row leading up to that national championship game versus Denver. Like, how confident were you coming into that game? Because you guys were just, in that season, just riding such a dominant streak there.
Well, yeah, like, at the beginning of the season, it just had a different feel. Like, we walked out to Nebraska, Omaha, and we were playing, you know, against Minnesota. They knew blank them 4-0. Like, it's just a dominant team effort by all of us. Then we played Wisconsin the next night and beat them like 2-1 or 3-1 or something like that. So, you know, we, you know, just started off on the right foot. And each week we just felt like we were getting better and better and better. And like, we didn't care, like, if it was run and gun or, you know, if we were locking it down. Like, it was you know, we felt just as comfortable being in a 1-0 game as, you know, like a 4-4 one. You know, like, even in the first round against Harvard, we were down 4-1, had the third, we scored 4 and answered to win 5-4. Like, it was, and then turned around and played Wisconsin the next day and won 2-1 in overtime. So we were just, you know, a team where we just felt very comfortable no matter what situation we were in, you know, going out there and we felt like, we're going you know, contributions from everyone. Plus, it helps that you have, you know, Dustin Penner rolling up front.
Right? Yeah, yeah, it always helps.
He was key.
Just, and you only played one season there, right?
One year. Yeah, he redshirted this freshman year, came and played his sophomore year, and then it was adios.
Yeah. Can you imagine if he would have stayed for the next one, too?
I mean,
it would have been nuts.
It would have been great. It was time for Tyler to, you know, move on. We got to hold that year after the year because he wanted to stay, and
they're
like, dude, go.
Dude, you're ready. Get paid right now. What about, I mean, we got to touch on just, you know, that after listening to the Chicklets interview, I forgot, like, a goal got called back, and I rewatched it. It was, like, within the first, like, what, 4 minutes for you guys? Just a terrible, you know, what, a toe in the crease call, like, you know, just talk about that and what, you know, living that was like.
I mean, but that was the rule back then.
Yeah.
Until the next year they changed it.
Yeah.
It's just a weird thing about it.
Yeah, like back then, like you couldn't, nobody, no matter if you're in the play or not, like the puck had to be in there before you could. That was the rule. You know, obviously now it's changed. You can be in the crease even if you know, the puck's not there and the puck can go in. That was a, you know, tough pill to swallow because I think, you know, with us scoring that early into the national championship game probably could change the, you know, the outcome of that game.
For sure.
But as we all know, we went the distance. We had our opportunities.
Yeah.
You know, we had a 6-on-3 at the end. We hit two posts and a crossbar. So, Burkle made some, you know, big saves for him. So it was a, one of those, it just wasn't our night.
That's fair. Yeah, I can imagine just being on the bench and see that 6-on-3 for like the last minute and a half and just watching the boys ring iron a few times, just going nuts. Like, so come on.
You just felt like a 6-on-3. It was like, oh, no brainer.
Yeah, like, yeah, you got
to
do
it. The fact that they were able to kill it off, it was sort of like, it was shock on the bench. It was like, no, they didn't.
Yeah, like, that didn't just happen.
Like, are you kidding me? They just killed that off. So, and since it was in Boston, like, we had a huge following there.
Yeah,
yeah, there was a lot of blue in the building.
It was a tough pill to swallow.
And I saw they did the zoom in on you, like, right after the game ended. And I just got to ask, can we talk about the puka shell necklace that you're rocking during your time at Maine? How about that style?
It had a life of its own at college.
Yeah?
I think it was my mom that gave it to me at my grandma.
Okay.
Just rocked it. They got so much, so many headlines. Like, this patrolling for, the national championship. And I was like, yeah, whatever. So I just rolled with it. And my mom, and like, I was so superstitious, and the season was going.
Yeah, you can't change it up.
You got it.
Zero chance of taking this thing off, even though I'm getting so much heat. I was like, there's no chance of
taking it off.
It's the whole reason I'm playing well.
Yeah, exactly. You know, it's in your head.
Shell necklace was the reason.
Yeah, it's the only thing working. Yeah.
From Puka to Gucci. I mean, now you're working.
What a journey.
What a journey it's been, man. I mean,
I think just had to stink by the end of the year. so many games going through, but I love it. Was some unreal style.
To be honest with you, I don't even think it was the same one from the start of the season. Yeah.
Man,
changed it up,
man.
One that it broke, but had to run the, what is it called? Pack Sun?
Yeah.
Man, I'm up there like you again, huh?
You
give me the usual.
Hey guys, let me just buy three or four. Yeah.
God, they should have puka shell necklace night. They should have naked five. The whole student section should wear one.
That would be electric.
There's an idea right now.
I forgot about the naked five. We're running around outside -30 out.
They took pictures outside of the arena when it was like, probably below zero this year, like when they couldn't even get into the games, just ready.
I love it, man. They're ready to be back in there. It's going to be a huge advantage for Maine to have them back next year. But talk about your time at Maine, though, just the Elf on itself, student section, all of it. You know, what made you fall in love with Maine on your visit?
Just the student section. I mean, those guys are crazy. The fact that there was no netting there when I was in school, I talked to other guys
yeah.
that, you know, played, you know, like, when I was like good buddies with Ryan Whitney, like we used to intentionally ring him off the pass by or send him up in the
what a dick.
Yeah, like guys used to do that. There's no netting back there. And you know, the student section, like the kids up there, they're nuts. They take the putts and whip them back down. Like,
oh man, I'm sure they're just ripping the opposing team. I'm sure Witt's just getting it on the ice.
Like, I was, like, at the other end of just watching them on their circle, and the guy's just bringing off the and I'm like, God, like, somebody's going to get absolute corked. And some nights, some did, but for the moment,
sometimes.
Yeah, because I'm sure there was no pregame going on before.
No, yeah, they're not watching. They're just hammered.
You know, very aware of their surroundings up there. But yeah, I mean, the Alphonse sold itself.
Like, yeah.
I mean, when I went there, they played Quinnipiac, and when Quinnipiac was just, you know, fairly new, D1 school, and I think they bought him 11-1, and the place was as loud for the 11th world as it was the first one.
That's great. That's good for hockey.
Jeez, there's no let up here. So that was you know, fun for me to watch.
I guess one thing I want to ask about is, you know, just as far as college hockey goes, you know, Syracuse has in New York, there, it's where you grew up. They have a women's college hockey team, but not a men's college hockey team. You know, could you, you know, potentially be part of that startup there and get Syracuse men's hockey, you know, back up to D1? That'd be sweet.
I don't know about that.
No,
nothing there.
You know, it'd be great to see it, you know, D1 hockey program. But, you know, I think it's just been amazing to sit back and watch how much it's grown.
Yeah.
You know, lately.
True.
I know we got the LIU. You know,
yeah, Long Island.
Said, like when we were getting, you know, recruited by, when we were out at the U.S. program, like the guys on the team, we'd be like, man, imagine if like the University of Miami, Arizona State had like a team, like,
right.
Well, we'd all go there and play. And now they do. It's like, you know, yeah. You see like Arizona State and the success that they've had and the recruits that they've been able to, you know, get, probably because the campus by itself. So,
yeah, and the new arena coming in too.
And they're getting the new arena there. So, it's just amazing to see like, you know, the Big Ten with Penn State, you know, coming in there and, you know, the new building at Notre Dame, you know, so it's awesome to see, you know, how college hockey has grown over the years.
100%.
Yeah. It's taken off. Like, I don't know. Obviously we're losing a couple programs that are, you know, just the smaller schools with tough funding, but you know, otherwise, like, yeah, I think Arizona State's huge for college hockey. Absolutely. Just to kind of show the blueprint for schools like that. Like, I mean, why doesn't Texas have a program, you know, or Florida, we put on Instagram the other week and it blew up, like those jerseys alone. People are like, yeah, I want to be a Gator, play some hockey out there. I mean, why not?
It
would kill those northern schools, though.
It would. And that's what I'm scared of.
I mean, let me see. Go to class in flip-flops or, you know, bungalow.
Yeah, right.
It's 20 below outside.
That's true. But the Naked Five, you know?
The Naked Five.
You gotta stay for the Naked Five.
Let me go there.
Another question I wanted to ask you, you know, like, how much of a difference is there, you know, between stopping the difficulty of like a D1 player, like a really good D1 guy versus an NHL guy? Like how hard of a transition was that for you?
I don't think it was shots or anything like that, like count wise, but you know, obviously, you know, it was more of like a big shock and awe. Like going from University of Maine college hockey back then, you know, you're big fish is, you know, a small pond, and then all of a sudden you become a small fish, a very big pond. I mean, at training camp, you had, Nick Lidstrom, Stevie Eiserman, Ben Chan, Chris Chelios. These are all guys sitting on, you know, next to the bus. And so it was more like all these future Hall of Famers, and not to mention, you know, Pat and all those guys. So, the biggest adjustment that I had an issue with my first couple of years was the schedule.
Yeah.
I mean, college hockey, you only
play games.
41 games, 42,
right,
to make it to the national championship. Like, that's half your season. That's your pro.
Yeah.
So, like, it was always like in February, I, you know, for the first couple of seasons, I was like, oh my God, I'm ready to be done. Like, just feel like it's,
Put in my time, boys.
It took me, you know, a couple of seasons to get adjusted to, you know, the schedule and the travel and the absolute grind of being a pro.
Yeah. What do you say? I mean, that was the grind of being a pro is harder than, you know, going to class and then just playing Friday, Saturday night. Obviously, you have practice throughout the week, but how much harder is the NHL schedule versus the college schedule, like weekly?
It's just, it's difficult because you're constantly on the ball.
Yeah.
Right. You never, like, when you're on the road, you're never in one spot for, you know, more than two nights.
Yeah.
So, I mean, you know, in college, it felt like, well, for us back in the day, like, whenever we traveled, we'd go to BC for two, we'd go to BU for two. So we'd always, you know, be in the same spot, you know, like, where the pro life, like, you're traveling, like, American League, you're on a bus, you know, some nights, you know, you may have to travel 6 hours after a game to play, you know, a game Sunday afternoon. It's your fourth game in five nights in a different city. So it was, you know, the grind of the travel and you know, the schedule to get, you know, the 82 games in was the biggest adjustment.
You talked about in the Chicklets pod, you know, knowing that you know, there's a good chance you're going to play Division One hockey. That was your goal once you made it to NTDP. But, like, when did you know that the NHL was, you know, in your future when you're at Maine there?
Actually started before then, like at the U.S. program.
Okay. Where,
you know, like, we played such a heavy university schedule that it felt like, I think it felt like for all of us, like, we were going to be able to make, you know, contribute as soon as we got to the university level. Like, Mike Eaves and John Heights did a great job of preparing us for that. And, I mean, I think it was when, you know, I signed on to go to the U.S. program that, doors started to open, you know, the NHL, you know, became, you know, more and more realization.
I mean, you had a hell of a career, man. That's just all around, like, just that's a journey. And when, I guess, like, you know, you started out playing goalie as a kid, correct? You never played player?
Yeah.
So, I mean, you were committed from an early age and sound like you know, I know, again, on the Chicklets pod, you're talking about your dad driving you to, what was it, Canada and to train all the time?
Yeah, my dad would drive me up once a week to do power skating in Ottawa and then with a goalie coach. And then that was always Sunday mornings. And then that was sort of like your tryout.
Yeah.
That goalie coach thought you know, had anything or had the tools. Then you get invited to, you know, the mini rink in the back where there's three pieces and you do, you know, one-on-one technical stuff training. So
cool.
It was like after a couple of years of power skating, I got the invite to go back there. And that's when, you know, everything really started to kick off. So I was like 12 or 13 years old. And then when I was 14 years old, I went to, you know, some junior B tryouts over there. And that's, you know, I just happened to make one of them. I wasn't expecting to make any of them.
Yeah.
And then when I was, you know, especially at the age of 14, and then all of a sudden made one of the teams and I was like, okay, so here I am. So
yes, we're doing
I
it.
Was 14 years old playing junior B. So it was an eye opener, you know, right away to be able to play against guys that are older than me. And some of them, you know, were 7 years older than me, being 21 years old. So, it was, you know, time to grow up fast.
One question I wanted to ask is, like, the NHL shootout rule kind of got initiated right when you jumped into the league there. Was that a hard adjustment to make, or, like, you know, just going up against guys that are, you know, insane if it goes out to you like that?
Oh, yeah. I mean, especially when the Hawks were in our division. Yeah, you see Patrick in the shootout, I was always like, let's be honest, like, the odds were not in my favor, especially when he was coming down. But I always, you know, relished the opportunity of getting, you know, the extra point for a team. It was sort of like scoring a goal.
Yeah, right.
It's like if anyone ever, you know, you try to explain it to you know, a common hockey fan, it's like, that's like scoring a goal from the shootout. Mm-hmm.
It's your chance to be on the highlight reel.
I'll jump up, they cheer, like, they do the same thing when they score, so I go, that's really like,
yeah, they do.
That's the scoring goal. So always
it's
the opportunity to, you know, it was on me to get the guys the extra point.
What about just in practice? I mean, you had some pretty insane guys on your team. Like, just shootouts in practice. What was that like? Did you guys practice that at all?
Duke out there.
Pav, I owned Pat.
From the blender.
Pat was great, but Pat never stopped. It was like, Pat, like, I'm tired. Or it was like, we were working on a power play, kind of killer in zone stuff. And the puck, you know, Babs would go to the other end. And to Pat, that was his screw around Pat. Oh, you know, do whatever I want the puck, and Jimmy's got to stop. Sometimes I was like, you know what, screw you, Pat. I'm not even giving up on that. He would still keep coming, keep coming, keep coming. I would be like, oh, dude, like, I just need, like, 3 seconds, catch my breath, get a swig of water, and I'll
just give me a break.
He was, you know, like, not all the stuff that he did, like, he gave, we saw him practice. So yeah. It never really surprised any of us, like, everyone else, like, when he had the puck on the stick.
Mm.
You know, brought to the edge of the seat. Like, to us, it was
just Pat, another day.
Pat. Yeah, normal thing.
Because we saw it every single day. The only time I think I've ever went, wow, was when I was at the All-Star game with him in Ottawa. And the puck got flipped up in the air. And he reached behind him and caught it on the blade of his stick, while still skating, you know, towards the other end. And then just pulled it in front of him. And I was like, no, he didn't. That might be the greatest, like, skill move ever. Like,
yeah.
Be able to catch that while skating out ice and pull it in front of you. I was like, wow.
Oh, he's playing lacrosse on the ice or something.
Yeah. You mentioned the All-Star game, but how cool was it to bring your kids there? And, you know, I saw that picture with your kids and Matthews in the locker room there, but talk about that whole experience and what that was like. You went a couple times. Was it 3 years?
3 years.
3 years. Yeah. So.
Yeah. That one was probably the most special because the boys were old enough.
Yeah.
Where they knew, you know, the time of the kid was,
mm-hmm.
you know, Nathan McKinnon and Sid and Cooch and Lundquist and.
Yeah.
To me, like, I'm just dad.
Yeah, you know, right.
They had more fun talking to, you know, oh my God, Dad, there's Marc-Andre Fleury. There's Connor. Dad, there's Connor. There's Connor McGee. Like, yeah, the buddy. Like, I don't know, we'll say hello.
Yeah. Yeah, I know them.
Not yet. And so, like, you know, they got a kick out of it. I think, like my youngest son, well, my younger son, Henry, like, I came into the dressing room and he was sitting there talking to Kucherov. And the next thing I hear out of Henry's mouth, it's like, yeah, you scored a lot of goals on my dad.
You scored a lot of goals on everybody.
Yeah, I mean, just to be able to see them, you know, light up and, you know, have all those guys, you know, because a lot of those guys that were there, you know, are dads.
Mm-hmm.
You know, to take the time out and you know, just, you know, say hello to the boys. You know, that's a lot.
Yeah, absolutely, and that's something your kids will never forget. Hopefully, you know, and
yeah, get them into the game early.
Just that's pretty cool.
I mean, I think Henry was more fired up to get Sharky's autograph. I'm sure. It'll click home here when
he
gets a little bit older.
Yeah, I mean, you talked about getting checklists, you know, you looking up to Dom and Ozzy there, I mean, going to the wins, but, like, what is it, the feeling like knowing that, like, guys like Swayman at Maine, you know, are now looking up to you with your, you know, success in the NHL and in college there?
He's such a smart kid, and he wants just to be, you know, the best that he's capable of being. Like, mm-hmm. I talked to him before the season started, and I was like, just be a sponge.
Yeah.
You just got to soak it all in, like, try to learn something new every single day. And, you know, you can always work, you're going to get better. And, you know, there's going to be times where, you know, things aren't going to go your way. And he's so mature about it. Like, he gets it. And I felt like I feel like I'm telling you stuff and you already know the answers to it. He's like, he's got that mature, you know, personality about himself that, you know, I think he's going to have one hell of a career for Boston.
So too, yeah, we had him on the podcast, was it 2 years ago?
No, that was last summer, wasn't it?
Or, last summer when he ended up winning, or he was in the Hobie finalist run there.
Yeah.
But I mean, just like,
record, so, yeah.
won the Richter, like just such a humble kid. And he seems like an old soul out there. And then he's seen, like, he's so loose on the ice, mm-hmm. minus that his warm-up routine, which is the funniest thing to watch. And he actually got in last night. We were rooting for him, hoping he's going to get his first playoff W, but you know, they kind of had to battle back anyways. But he's just so fun to watch.
Tough. It was,
that was a tall task for that night.
Yeah. I didn't even think they'd get close.
Do you think he'll get the start next game? Do you think they'll start him next game or no?
That'd be sweet.
No, we'll go back.
They got to go to that.
We'll go back to Turk.
Yeah.
And
then
that's the previous
team
until Tupi
doesn't want to play. Yeah, that's fair. Yeah,
that's
totally fair.
Yeah, but I mean, he's, man, like the talent there and the way he thinks the game, like, mm-hmm. Swayze is, you know, he's going to have, you know, a long, long career. I mean, hell, even the start to his, you know, young career here has been, you know, something remarkable.
Yeah, absolutely.
100%. What he's been able to do there in Boston.
Who did you, you know, Tuca's maybe one of them, but who did you look up to when you got to the show, other than, you know, your teammates there, but what other goalie did you like to face?
I mean, I love watching other guys to see if I could learn things.
Yeah.
You know, whether, you know, I had an off night, I was able to watch, like, Lundqvist, you know, just the way he competes on every single puck.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Terry, just because, well, let's be honest, he makes it look so freaking easy. And it's not. You know, with how smooth he is out there on the ice, and it's like, man, is his heart rate go over 100? Like, doesn't look it. But those are two guys that I really enjoyed watching. You know, Quickie.
Yeah.
Loved watching, you know, Quickie play, and just, you know, he was so flexible that he was never out of it. Like, you could, you know, always, you know, possibly get a piece of equipment on it. So. You know, those are the three guys, and Pekarene.
Yeah.
And
all solid.
This compete level. So I always enjoy watching those guys to see if I can pick something up.
I wanted to ask about Babcock, you know, being your coach for so long at the Red Wings there, and he spent a little bit of time on the Vermont coaching staff this season. You know, could you see him potentially coaching college hockey at the end of his career here? Like, do you think his hard-nosed style would work in college hockey? Yeah.
He's going back to Saskatchewan University to coach.
Oh, really?
I did not know that.
I didn't even know that. Oh, boy. I mean, how's that going to work out for him? That's going to be electric. I mean, is he going to be bag skating people out there or what?
You know what? I don't think in my career we ever had a bag skate with him.
Wow.
Really?
That's surprising.
That's not how I would think.
Yeah, right? Exactly. Yeah. I don't remember him ever lining us up. It might be a hidden bagger where,
you
know, either the goalies were getting just absolutely blitzed with shots, or guys were going up and down the ice.
Yeah.
And that's that. But he never, you know, personally lined us up and made us, you know, go until he was satisfied. It was, he always called them work days.
Yeah, work days. That's what he knows. Shit. You
know, time to go to work.
Definitely a good mentor. You had a lot of them, but
he's beauty. And he was on, I've seen him on the NHL network too. He's a good commentator.
Oh, yeah.
You can tell he just knows his stuff, and, you know, he could talk there too.
He definitely knows his stuff. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Probably like X's and O's of his, the way he prepared us was top notch. Mm-hmm. It's just, I mean, it's no secret.
Yeah.
Very true, guys. So.
Yeah,
but that was him, you know, trying to push your buttons to, you know, so he could get the best out of it.
Yeah.
Right, that's what great coaches do. Would you, I mean, you're coaching your sons now. Do you have any interest in coaching in, you know, professional hockey one day?
Zero. Zero. Flat zero. Just because those guys' schedules are worse than, you know, a player's.
Yeah, yeah.
They're always there.
They're at the arena like at 7 a.m. And if it's a game day, they're not home until like midnight or 1 o'clock in the morning, and they're doing it all over again. Not only that, they're living in front of the computers.
Yeah, that's tough.
But
true.
No thanks. I love hockey. But I don't love it that much.
That's fair.
And then they got to deal with all the different egos and everything like that.
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
Yeah. No thanks.
Being on the other side of it.
Yeah, absolutely.
Stirring the pot with all the drama going on rather than, you know, having to.
Yeah. Yeah. I'd rather be in the stands chirping parents.
Chirping parents.
Having a good time out there.
But as a mentor, like, what advice would you give to, well, as goalies or players, you know, the youth, what advice would you give them to make it to the Division I level and, you know, the NHL level?
Good question.
I mean, there's definitely, you know, some luck involved, but if you have a dream, like me growing up in a small town up in upstate New York, like people were always thought my dad and I were crazy for how much he drove me around. But I had a dream and I just kept, you know, going for it. I wasn't going to be denied. And I think that's the biggest thing is the, you know, the hard work and everything like that. There's enough scouts. There's enough, you know, recruiters out there now. Like if you work hard and put in the time, you know, doors will open for you.
That's a great answer.
Yeah, that is good.
I'm looking at you like you're crazy and then just putting in the work and, you know, look at you now.
Look at you.
Obviously, everything paid off.
Yeah, I mean, I respect the show, Jimmy. Thanks so much for coming on, man. Like,
we really, really appreciate your time, Jimmy. This has been awesome. And thanks for coming on. Hopefully, we'll get a Maine jersey up here soon, too. So, you know, the studio will look better next time.
No problem, guys. Thanks for having me. I love that you guys are doing something for college hockey.
Hey, man, we appreciate it.
It doesn't get enough.
I think so. It's guys like you that, you know, support us, that, you know, keep it going. So, and tell Whit we appreciate his help too. And Spin Chicken's helping us out. It's just by following us, you know, that helps us grow the game. So,
no problem, guys.
All right,
Detroit Red Wings playing in the expansion round. Jimmy Howard comes over on Reeves and makes the save. Eckholm couldn't get through. Arvidsson's got it again. Throws it off to Forsberg. Forsberg right out of goal. Jimmy Howard has been spectacular. We haven't even played 7 minutes.
Scribble there, gives back to Stahl. One of the Red Wings has a stick broken. Oh, and reaching out of the air and grabbing that attempt was Jimmy Howard.
Another way for DeZingle again. And then Smith's shot. Rebound was there right in front of the net. What a save by Howard.
In front for Pasha. Oh, what a save by Howard. Oh, the rebound. What a goal. Broussard right in. Howard the save. The Red Wings win it. Start the season 2-0. The right-handed catching netminder from the lefty in front. Good save there by Howard. Howard scrambling to get back in on Stepan. Another stop by Howard. DeClaire now with some space and with some speed. Save Howard. Rebound. Down low in front by Mark DeKeller. Looking for the hat trick. Jimmy Howard. Great stop diving. Desperation save to keep this 2-2. Here comes.